Hey, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. Oh, here comes Gregory
I'm a fan,
Lunsford.
by the way. I follow your channel.
Well, thank you. Yeah, it's my happy place. So you're back home in Italy?
I am in Milan, yeah.
So you, because would you normally have come back to America to do press and all that stuff, or are you kind of, is everything staying in place
Well, to
this time?
tell you the truth, this is the first film it's my second feature, and it's the my first feature wasn't released in America. So, I mean, I've been to America for work a bunch of times, but never really to promote my own film with like this. This is my first time, and it happens from my house.
Did Netflix send you the ring light, the official Netflix ring light, or did you get the
It
whole
did for
setup?
something, but then I had to send it back to them. So now I'm just using my own house lights.
Your actual lights.
I got key lights.
There you go. You could bring in a cinematographer to shoot this.
I wish. And then I think, okay, then the light's gonna change because now it's evening, right? So
Exactly.
that's gonna be different. Who knows what's gonna happen?
Well, I actually have a few of these interviews where, like, Robert Pattinson was on my porch, and through the interview, it got darker and darker and darker until it was pitch black
Right.
behind him, which people seem to like. I don't know.
It's conceptual art.
It is. It becomes very conceptual art. So, have you been in lockdown this whole time, or is Italy a little more flexible, or?
No, I mean, actually, we were very early in the first lockdown last year. In March, we started the lockdown, and it was right away the most aggressive thing it could ever be. Like, you cannot leave your house unless to buy groceries. So we experienced that very hardcore. And then, by last summer, there was a bit of release because, of course, we all thought things were going a little better. And then in the fall, it started again, softer that time. So, no, it's just an Italian, another version of hard and traumatic lockdown. I'm not sure it's better or worse. It is what it is. And we live through it.
And where were you in the picture when this all started?
When this all started.
When the lockdown stuff started, were you already cutting, I assume? Were you?
Oh, with the picture. No, we were basically wrapped. We had just a few post-production things to wrap up. Sound mix and just a few. Actually, we'd done most of the sound mix. We just had some pickup sound mix and just some small things to add. So we were lucky that way. We got most of the bulk before this all started.
So has it been, so were you writing this whole time during the lockdown, or were you, what were you doing when
I
this started?
was, I was. I mean, I was both dealing with the wrapping up of this film, and writing, and then of course, Netflix picked up the film and the whole collaboration with them and creating the marketing, and in parallel writing. All of the above. And also just dealing with life
Oh, that again.
in its current incarnation.
Yes, it's unstoppable, this thing called life. So you were always a director, it seems. It seems like that has been your trajectory from the beginning. Yeah.
Look, from about the age of your child, I started becoming obsessed with films, and just watching. No matter what the censors said, what was on the tapes, because we would rent tapes, we would, me and my friends, we would just watch everything. Of course, with the interests of an 11, 12, 13-year-old. But then, something in my personal life happened. I moved when I was 13. I moved to America for 2 years. In Boston, with my immediate family, my mom, my stepdad, and my brother. And there, I of course had no friends. I actually didn't speak very much English at all, which of course I sort of it was a life crash course. So I kind of learned English quickly because I went to a normal American public high school. So you just But in that context, I started what was before just the fun of watching films with my peers. I started becoming a bit more obsessive and started reading books about film, renting films with criteria, not just sort of, oh, this looks cool, but like, okay, I like the films of Brian De Palma. I want to watch everything he ever made, you know? And so I would go and the Hollywood video guys were, hey, what's up? What is it today? You know, which ones? So as early as then is when I started to become, I guess, a film buff in a more organized sort of way. Mm-hmm. And then, again, reading.
What was your favorite books? What were what were the most helpful books, I guess, in your experience?
Well, look, I guess the first books I read were probably the ones that today I would be more like, I remember reading a book by Sid Field. When you're that young, everything just seems more accessible. But it wasn't...
Yeah, Beckett kind of kicked Sid Field in the balls, I'd say.
It was, huh?
Beckett kind of kicks Sid Field in the balls.
Exactly. But the good thing about that book, which I picked at random, was it wasn't... I forget what it's called, screenplay. Right. It wasn't screenplay. It was an autobiography. So he was talking about himself moving through the industry and how that sort of, and in parallel, his love for movies and why his love for movies. And then eventually he got to how he came up with his theories, which to me seemed cool at the time. But anyway, it just, you know, it was my first sort of impression into, this can be a life. You know, you can live in movies and work in movies. But, you know, going back to Brian De Palma, he was definitely the first filmmaker I fell in love with, because I started realizing of all the films I was watching, I was kind of drawn to his movies consistently. And that's when I started realizing, okay, so there's a vision behind these, which is consistent throughout the different movies. And many of them are very different movies on paper.
Right.
So I guess some of my first books were about him. And those probably are some of the most significant for my first impression of filmmaking. And then definitely the most important one, I would say, that equally I cherished at the time, or a little later actually, and I still hold dear now, is simply Stanley Kubrick interviews. Mm. Which, as you know, he didn't do many, and this is an amazing collection, and all, it's basically film school as far as I'm concerned, so I guess that's the book I hold most dear in terms of, you know, establishing an identity or a practical toolbox of a way to look at problems as a filmmaker does. With that American sort of parenthesis in my life, mm-hmm. that's when I started cultivating my love for film. And in parallel with the realization that there was one man behind Brian De Palma's movies, imagining, well, I want to do that. I want to have my own vision and do different types of movies, but, you know, from my point of view, just like he does.
Right.
So, you know, that was the dream of a little kid. And eventually with years of, watching movies and reading and studying, I cultivated the dream, and eventually it happened. I have to say, a lot of inspiration in terms of where I stand, not so much technically, but as my point of view, comes from literature as much as it does from cinema. Because I remember reading in a Truffaut interview, I think, that he said, you know, if you want to learn filmmaking, you have to read novels. And I was like, oh, okay, I'll read novels. And I did realize what he meant in the, you know, the essence of finding the stripped down essential narrative, in the best books, that is. So I would take that in parallel to film inspiration and location.
I'm guessing you were, based on your age, you were kind of towards the end of the De Palma great run when you discovered De Palma as a thing. It must have been around Snake Eyes or something, or?
Well, I saw Snake Eyes in the theater. I saw Mission to Mars in the theater, which I love, by the way.
You're a Mission to Mars person. That's one of the defining separators in show business, I think.
I think Mission to Mars is an amazing movie. I actually saw it. I ended up living next door to the movie theater I saw that movie in. I still remember very vividly. There were like five of us in the theater. And then Femme Fatale also. I mean, that's a great movie. So, yeah, of course, in the 90s, that's when I came close to him. So I discovered his earlier films later. Yes.
And then you headed back to Italy, as it turned out?
Yeah, I stayed 2 years in Boston. And then I came back to Milan, where I'm from, where I grew up. And I lived here and I still live here. Although between then and now, I kind of moved around a little bit. I spent some time in London. I spent some time in Rome, depending on. I studied in Bologna University, which is 2 hours and a half south of here. So this was always kind of my base camp. I moved around a bunch for, you know, for study or work.
And was the nonfiction work that you did early on, was that something that was doable, or was that a passion of yours? Were you thinking maybe of being a documentarian?
No, I was not. Again, starting from The Man, De Palma, and then of course that stemmed into love for many other filmmakers of many other nationalities. I was always dreaming of fiction. But that said, I'm also, you know, I like many things about cinema. So I'm equally drawn to exploring documentary. It depends what the story is and if that's the best form to explore it. So it you know, I did some of that because I came upon it. But I guess more, I'm generally more drawn to fiction. But as another great master, Herzog, says, you know, it depends what the point of view is. There's as much reality in fiction as there can be fiction in documentary. And I'm with that.
Well, Herzog certainly, he's gone both ways with his films. I mean, one of the great things I ever bought was a collection of all of his documentaries from German television from the 70s and the 60s, right, even, which is quite amazing. And then, of course, he made a number of features off of those documentaries later on. So
yeah,
it's a fascinating, it's amazing actually also, of course, now I'm having a brain damage, but the great Austrian director.
Who Peter Weir?
No, he's Australian. We're off by a couple, by an L. Haneke. Haneke did.
Austrian. Okay.
Yes. Haneke did a bunch of documentaries for television and did a lot of television work early on. And people were kind of, one of the times I interviewed him, I talked about it with him, and people were like offended that I even brought up that he had done television. But it's how a lot of these great directors came up.
I mean, Friedkin started doing a million live shows, of all things, and then became one of the most amazing fiction filmmakers ever.
And then went to do opera since then.
Yeah.
The last 20 years, he's done a bunch of operas.
Yeah.
So how did you end up hooking up with Luca?
I was, studying in Bologna, you know, Italian university is we don't have in the university system. If you study cinema, you study cinema history, analysis, you read books, you watch movies. That's what it is. They don't have cameras or anything. So, you know, that was what I had access to.
Right.
I did that. And then after that, of course, I was thirsty for, you know, making or watching people making films. And so I desperately looked for jobs as an assistant director. And actually the first job I found was in the UK on a film called The Other Man by Richard Eyre. Mm-hmm. What I did in that film was completely irrelevant to the outcome of the film, but I did learn what everybody's role was on set, which mm-hmm. comes out later as something very important.
Yeah.
When I had my first crew. When I came back, to Milan after that movie was exactly when Luca Guadagnino was coming to Milan to develop and prep I Am Love. And he was looking for people to help him find locations, people who real people who would be in his film, not necessarily actors for the smaller roles and other things like that. And of course, I was looking for a job. And then so therefore, through connected people, they interconnected us and we met. And I worked on that film as an assistant director. Then, of course, he also, we had a great connection, and I think in the process of the film, he gave me more and more little responsibilities of things. You know, in the first film I did as an AD, I kind of held ladders and rung a bell when they started shooting. And in this film, I did more interesting things was able to be much closer to the action. That's how we met. And then, you know, after that, I wrote an idea for a short film, which I showed him, and then he showed to Marco Morabito, his producing partner, and they liked it, and they're like, oh, we want to produce this. So that was the magic.
So how different is a Richard Eyre set versus a Luca Guadagnino set?
I guess it's more efficient to talk about the similarities. there are none. there was a very well-oiled, efficient structure on the Richard Eyre set, which I felt was it's following a specific set of rules. Liam Neeson was in that movie, so a specific set of skills came to mind, but I meant rules. And so I was just, you know, watching and seeing, all right, that works that way, that works that way. This is my place. And, you know, each one does their own thing. Mm-hmm. And on I Am Love, I saw a much more open and collaborative group of people, speaking more openly and there wasn't this idea of compartmentalized roles. Each one had their role, as is normal, but there was a more open dialogue. And Luca was very open as a filmmaker to be inspired by even my mere presence there so close to when they were actually staging the scenes and everything is a testament to this. I, in the Richard Eyre set, I was miles away from the actors.
Right.
So it was a much more of a choral effort, a family effort, if you will. And that was, you know, extremely different.
And I assume that's what you took on more in terms of your own style.
Yeah, look, like I said earlier, I when I started to learn about cinema and to love cinema, I watched films from all over the world. And I liked many different genres. So to give you a specific example, when inspired by this openness, obviously, when it came time to decide, all right, who should we ask to make to be the DP of my first feature? I said, well, my favorite DP in the whole world in independent cinema is Sayumbu Mukti Prom. He shoots the films of Apichat Prom, Varasate Kul, like Uncle Bunme. Okay, well, let's try to get in touch with him. And so we did. And, you know, to me, it was a no-brainer. Like, I had to make a movie about a poet and her sort of relationship with nature was very important to portraying her and her story. Mm-hmm. And, seeing the movies that Sayumbu made with Apichat Prom, I saw this amazing natural light and this interaction with nature that was seamless, but also poetic. So to me, it was a no-brainer. It's like, that's the perfect guy. I don't, you know, he's Thai, whatever. I hope he speaks English, you know? So we got in touch with him. He did speak English. And I got to meet him. I went to Thailand to meet him. It was my first trip to Asia in general. And we spent some great time together. And we came to an understanding from our completely different backgrounds to, you know, what is the movie that we want to make? You know, this portrait of a poet. And in this sense, yes, I retain that openness and that considering all of the filmmakers of the world as sort of part of a nation cinema. And therefore, you know, who is the best person to cover this role, whether it's an actor or a collaborator,
right?
It doesn't matter where they're from.
So on, so what were the origins of Beckett? Where did you come up with this idea?
Well, I love this genre, let's say manhunt thriller with a political background. Mm-hmm. This sort of general recipe, I always loved very much, both in books and in movies. Mm-hmm. And in books and movies when they sort of interact or adapt to each other in many of its iterations, because I guess focusing on the 20th century, in the first part of the 20th century, more on literature than on cinema, but with some outcome in cinema in terms of adaptations. And then in the second part of the 20th century, more, especially thinking of the 70s, much more in cinema, with that sort of paranoia of that time. So I enjoyed those things very much for a number of reasons, one of them being the very sort of efficient narrative concept of having so much, such a wide scope, and in some ways responsibility fall on the shoulders of a single character. That sort of immediacy and at the same time scope was very appealing and interesting to me and fun. You know, just the context in which some of these movies lived, and it was very inspiring to me, and what it can, you know, that play with, yes, genre and like adventure and action, but also a heart, a sort of, it's a vessel for something else. And therefore, the idea was, okay, let's take the context, let's take the archetype, but what can be interesting to be made now, or anyway, what is appealing to me?
Right.
And the first thing was character. Like, okay, I would like for this story to have a character that's not usually in this type of movie. He's not a spy, a former cop, a soldier, whatever. There's no secret. He's just a normal guy. On top of that, he's also a guy who is particularly unfit for a situation like this, mm-hmm. and is going through a sort of personal crisis. In other words, a dramatic character at the heart of the manhunt thriller. So that was my first sort of angle. And that led inevitably to finding a tone that would accommodate this, which to me had to be a grounded tone. And not heightened like many of the films that we're evoking. You know, they have this either heightened or even fantastic aspect to them, whether it's in the amazing things that happen in the story that are like, I would say, supernatural almost,
right.
Or because the hero simply, you have this feeling that he'll figure it out. I'm sure it'll work. You know, he's cool enough, he's smart enough to figure it out.
Right.
And it was interesting to me, like, okay, let's play with this box, but let's put someone in there that we can relate to and that we can think, actually, I have no idea how he's going to get out of this, you know, or actually I relate to that confusion. I also feel confused in the same way he does. So, you know, and that also led to the idea of experiencing all of it through him instead of being sort of omniscient. And so those were, I guess, the inspiration and the premise, the angle that I wanted to use to approach it.
So did you have a hard script that never changed from the beginning, or did you consider other options as you went along?
Well, started from a story. I would say the skeleton of it, the character part of it, more or less stayed the same throughout.
Right.
The character's journey, what the premise of his personality and position in the world and the way he relates to the world, and then how that is challenged and what happens to it in the end of the film, that stayed the same throughout. Everything that's around it changed. through various incarnations. First of all, you know, I kind of established this premise, but then I collaborated with a writer, an American writer, Kevin Rice, because I like the idea of coming with my European background and collaborating with an American writer who, you know, he went to AFI and he's got a very scientific mind when it comes to writing. And I like this sort of the two different baggages contributing to the one movie, which has both parts to it, because, you know, you, of course, we have this dramatic character at the core, but you also need to pay your due to the genre requirements.
Right.
So through that collaboration and through a couple of incarnations of the script, things changed, but the skeleton of Beckett remained the same.
So, I mean, it's interesting because you're doing a very, in some ways, very 70s, because you do take your time to get, to let the characters become the characters. On the other hand, John David Washington is kind of seen as kind of a muscular, action-y kind of guy. And it was an interesting choice because it was, at first you think he might be that guy who has a special set of skills. And then you find out he really doesn't through the movie.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's why the movie begins the way it does, is it's, you know, at the beginning of the film, it's my idea was if we start, it's like a drama, you know, you see this couple and, you know, they're in love, obviously, they're having a trip and you see them dealing with couple things. And he, again, she's actually the more dominant personality in the couple. He's just, you know, he's just in love and so is she, and kind of happy to be there and everything. So the fact that he remains that guy throughout the adventure, that's exactly what was interesting to me. You know, seeing how that guy reacts to people shooting at him, or how he deals with running for so much and slipping and, you know, running into things and strangers in his way and cats, you name it. I was just, again, that was the priority. And so I think with so many films that have been made in the genre, that was what was interesting to me.
Was it something that was interesting to him particularly? Is that why he came on board, do you think?
I think, I mean, look, he reacted to the script. That's how we got to meet. And inevitably it had to be because of that, because the character stood out, first of all, as a very central to the development of the story, but also as an unusual character for that type of story to begin with. So I think, yes, inevitably he found himself drawn to the idea that he's not your typical hero and that he is actually just figuring it out as it's unfolding and trying to piece it together as it's unfolding, as a very uninformed random guy. And then, you know, we spoke about it a lot in our conversations, you know, before making the film, and we, you know, this was a lot of what we talked about and how does that translate to, you know, a performance and what happens in specific situations. It was always through this prism.
And Alicia, you got a performance out of her. I've been a fan of her since the first time I saw her. I went back to see her earlier films. I've seen everything she's done. And you got, I think, you know, maybe having a kid has changed her in many ways, but you got something really gentle and lovely and happy out of her that I haven't really seen before.
Look, to me, that was a no-brainer. That obviously her character has exactly those things to do at the beginning of the film, to establish what their relationship is, how different they are. And she has this energy that of course it's fuel to him. And to me, Alicia has, you know, she kind of lights up the screen and is able to convey so much energy with so little that it just, you know, it's a dream come true. Because again, the efficiency of having fewer scenes, but having to deliver so much energy in them, she just sort of has that power and that immediacy.
So as you're going through it, then the rest of the picture is mostly people that in America we haven't seen much of. I don't know, how are any of those people famous actors at home that we should know?
In Greece? In Greece, well, yeah, actually, some of the most famous actors do the smallest roles. They were generous enough and excited enough that this movie was there that they were like, sure, I'll come for one day or 2 days. It's cool. So that, you know, like the guy who he has the fight with in the underground station is one of the most important actors in Greece. I built a special relationship with Panos Koronis, who plays the cop in the film, who is an actor in some Greek films. He's actually a director of commercials, but he does act in films sometimes. And he was an actor. He studied acting in Los Angeles a few years ago. So he has a very interesting story. And we have seen him in some of the Greek films that have been distributed around the world. Mm-hmm. But he's amazing to me. I want to work with him again. He's so specific and ironic in the best possible way.
Was it always Greece?
It wasn't. It was in a different country earlier. And then Greece seemed like it could host both what we needed for the social political background of the story, because of course it hosts the complications that the story does. You know, Greece had a very specific, difficult few years in the past 10 plus years. And it's also because of its relationship with Europe. So that was simply an interesting context for me to explore, because I found it to be significant. They suffered most in Europe from what was going on in those last 10 years. But what I found most interesting was the way that the Greek people needed to engage and enter in action and go to the street and, you know, find a community and speak up to say, you know, what they disagreed with. That was a very important element to infuse in the film and in some way inspire Beckett as a character. And then on the other hand, with the premise of trying to explore a foreign land that's maybe not as seen in international cinema, the idea was, wait, what about mainland Greece? You know, scratch the islands, scratch the golden summer and you know, Acropolis, whatever. Let's look at mainland Greece. You know, what is there to discover? And I went on this amazing trip, literally just driving around all of mainland Greece and discovered, you know, and adapted. I had sort of some requirements from the story of things that I needed, but then completely just awestruck by the beauty of the things I was seeing, the variety, this can be this can be that, and kind of also backward engineering some scenes based on the amazing locations that I was finding, so that we could have, you know, this road movie element of the film that's kind of, you know, the landscape changes, you know, it starts in the mountains there and then it kind of becomes more plain-like, and then there's the smaller city, and then, you know, we could nail all of those things. And that was very much inspired by literally driving around Greece.
Mm. Well, as you went along, I mean, as you were talking about from the beginning, that it's a fascinating mixture of an action film and basically a personal drama. And I'm wondering how it was to regulate that for you as you went along, whether there were like, oh, we got to do a little less, like, because the one thing that sticks out in the movie to me, I'll be honest with you, is him jumping at the, from the, in the parking garage, the leap.
Spoiler alert.
Huh?
Spoiler alert.
Yeah, I don't want to, well, nobody will have any context for it if they're listening to this first. So there's that. But that was the first thing I was like, oh my God, that's, it's like a regular movie.
Well, but, to be fair, he does do something like that earlier in the film, yeah, more than once.
Yeah.
So it's not out of the blue per se.
It's interesting. I mean, was it interesting maintaining that modulation as you went along? Was there instance, yes, like, okay, let's go a little heavier on this or a little lighter on this?
Yeah, because and it was delicate, but again, the central rudder, if that's the right term, was the character at all times. So even when he did something crazy like that, you know, what's going on with the character? And that, at that moment, again, I don't want to spoil the end too much, okay, but there was something about this decision to do engage in action no matter what.
Mm-hmm.
So that justified that for me.
So keep moving forward no matter what.
Yeah. Okay. There's no way I'm letting this slip, you know, whereas in the beginning of the film, it was different.
Right.
It was actually, I'll try to avoid this at all costs. So all of those decisions always informed by, would he do this? Would he not do this? Depending on where he was. So yeah, it's always a dance between character, tone, and genre when you're playing with genre. And it is delicate, but again, I always kind of went back to character to decide what would work, I guess, in this balance.
And was Mr. Washington locked in from the beginning? Did he know where his character was going through all this in his actor's mind and stick with it? Or did it require some prodding and pushing as a director? I mean, it seems like he really is like deep in there from the very
beginning. What I can say about Sean David is that he is passionate and obsessive like me, which was good when I shared a bunch of material with him, he ate it up. And then he is also reckless because he wants to do everything, you know, he wants to do his own stunts. He wants to, you know, run all the, he doesn't want people to run for him. He wants to run it. And, in fact, technically speaking, he probably ran more than the character because he had to do takes, whereas the character only had to run through things once, right? So I think he that was part of the mission, you know. And John David has a sports background. He was a football player, so I think that physical aspect of it also kind of appealed to him a little bit in terms of what the character needed to go through physically.
And how was post for you? Was this all clean enough? And I don't know what your budget was like, but I imagine you don't have a million rolls, extra feet of film lying around on the floor. Was it all kind of where you wanted it to be when you went to post, or did you have to find the movie a bit in post?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, look, if you look at it in general terms, this is not a huge film. If you look at it from a European perspective, it's a bigger film than average.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, from my point of view, this is my second feature. I was just lucky that I was able to do it. So of course, you know, during the shooting, there was the epic problem of time. And of course, also because the movie is shot in every day in a different location, mm-hmm. a lot of the time was invested in traveling. So I struggled with that, but also, you know, it came with the territory. And right. In post-production...
You can't blame the writer.
Huh?
You can't really blame the writer, since it's you.
No, that was the point of the movie. the movie travels, so you gotta suffer the same consequences. And in post-production, no, I was lucky. I was lucky to you know, I worked with amazing teams. When some things on set didn't work exactly in terms of, you know, we did everything we could on camera in terms of special effects mm-hmm. and squibs and all those things. A couple of things didn't work, and I was lucky enough, and that was not in the plans, to even work with Weta Digital, who I get through the work of my producers and an amazing visual effects producer. We got in touch with them and they're like, look, we're doing so many blue faces, we're happy to do something that's not blue. I even got the chance to work with them on some mini moments of the film. So no, I absolutely can't complain. It was difficult, but I think it's always difficult. So it was fine. It was a privilege.
But was it... In terms of the story, in terms of the movie that you ended up with, was it the movie? Did you know what you had going into post, or did you have to reset tone and reset? Is it a different movie than you think than you shot at all, or was it?
No. In fact, I wasn't really able, unfortunately, to edit during the shooting. So I was afraid of that. but no, the tone remained basically the same. Some scenes changed a little bit, they came a little shorter. Some scenes, a couple of scenes changed in order, but I would say that the tone and scope of the film remained the same. You know, it was pretty ambitious to begin with. So just the fact that we got what we got on film was remarkable enough.
Yeah. Well, I'm assuming you'll feel relief when it finally does open on Netflix.
Yeah, it's been a while. I mean, I've worked on this film for like 6 years at this point, so I'm happy for it to come out.
I assume the next one will be a little quicker.
Look, I hope so.
Will you go back and work with Luca again, or are you on your own now?
Who knows? I'm writing, and we'll see. I'm writing. I'll see what the best solution is.
But this is your thing. You're going to be a director, a writer, director for the rest of your career, you think?
Well, I feel like I have been, at least since I was mature enough to, you know, pay for my own rent.
Yeah. No, that's the thing I find, you know, I guess people look to the relationship with Luca as something that's a lot of your resume. And at the same time, clearly you've been making films throughout the whole process. Even before you met Luca, you have films on your resume. So.
Well, I started doing little silly things for the internet and helping friends out with whatever video stuff they needed. And then, you know, eventually smaller becomes small and small becomes medium sized and then bigger and bigger. Of course, in my collaboration with him, he was the first person to empower me, meaning the ambitious ideas I had as a filmmaker were, of course, outsized my position, but he believed in me, and you know, and Marco, his producing partner, did as well. And they're like, no, I mean, this idea, this little idea that you have, let's make it pro, you know. So that was definitely, you know, central to my development as a filmmaker.
Well, I think people are going to be, I think this is one of those films people are going to watch for John David or for Alicia or whatever, and then be surprised by what they get in a happy way.
Cool.
So
it's, thank you.
It's a challenging, it's a surprising film. It's not nearly really what you expect from it, even from the beginning to the middle. It keeps on evolving.
Well, like I said, hope so. Look, I like when that happens. So I really hope so.
Yeah. It's not 3 Days of the Condor, but it's kinda. You know, some of that. It's got that
something more in line with today.
We don't have nearly enough nudity to be like Brian De Palma, but maybe we'll see that movie someday. Brian's still out there.
If the story needs it. If the story needs it.
Did you ever get to meet Brian?
I did.
You did?
I did. I was with Luca and with Walter Fasano, and all three of us are equally Brian De Palma nerds. So for the other people at the dinner, it was a very boring dinner because we nerded out like crazy. Like, you know, is it true that they stole your footage on the while you were shooting Blowout? It was very fun. It was amazing.
Well, you're gonna have to have more of those. And Brian's still trying to work, so it's hopefully he'll have some more movies too. It's a pleasure meeting you. Thank you for your time, and thank you for your movie. And I'm looking forward to the next one already.
So am I.
Thank you, David. So thanks, everyone.